This here is a WS2812B from World Semi. These little guys have been around for a while. They run about 30 cents a piece, but the thing that makes them really cool is they're individually controlled red, blue, and green LEDs. They're digitally controlled by virtue of having that tiny little integrated circuit right there on die. They can be chained together to be many, many LEDs long. These little guys support 24-bit color. That's 8 for red, green, and blue. Each one of these bits has to be sent out over the wire, but we only have one wire, so we have to encode our bits using a very precise timing. And it's kind of annoying, but kind of cool, because now with one wire, we can control zeros, ones, or even reset the whole strip. By sending a zero, we send it on for a short period, then off, or a 1, we send it on for longer, then off for less. But the timing is restrictive. Conveniently, Tim over at CPLD CPU has compiled a chart that gives a much better idea as to what the timings really are. This was really cool. Every month it felt like somebody was coming up with a new way of controlling these, through DMA off of an STM to SPI on a PIC. Except for the ESP8266, the only thing I was aware of was my thing, which was terrible because it just sat there and waited through all of those periods, and I needed my CPU because I wanted to run color cord on it. So I was going to need to do something different. That difference came when SpriteTM posted this, an ESP8266 MPEG-3 decoder with, here's the kicker, I2S support. The reason that I2S was so important was now, instead of manually controlling the output pin and spending an enormous amount of time doing that, information could be loaded into RAM, and hardware, DMA, on the chip could just simply shift this out as I2S data. Unfortunately, at the time of creating this video, I haven't really figured out a way of one-shotting the DMA for the I2S. I'm sure that somebody maybe more well-connected or just smarter than I am would be able to figure that part out. But here's the neat thing. We have a whole data block of WS2812 data. We have some zeros to send that reset pulse. We have to figure out how to set up this data in the WS2812 data. These are actually just bytes of RAM. Each byte has 8 bits, and each one of those bits gets shifted out of this data register at a variable speed. We can control it so that we can get our timing right, and we don't have to worry about any finicky CPU cycles. There are two ways that you can do it, at least that other people do it. I'm sure that there are many more. The first one that I saw was with the SPI on the PIC project, where they'll use 3 samples, and to make a zero, what they'll do is they'll turn it high, low, low. And what that does is produce a very short high pulse and a longer low pulse, or high, high, low. And that produces a longer high pulse and a shorter low pulse. That's just fine. It takes a little bit extra effort, though, to create this, and in the event of something like an STM32, if you're using SPI, you don't have that great control over the port, and you need better timing windows. You can actually get that by making 4 samples instead of 3, where it's on for a very, very small amount of time and off for longer, or on for a much longer period of time and off for a very short period of time. You then take these slices and you stack them together end to end in RAM. And this is what the actual DMA will output. So under the first scheme, it takes 24 bits of space to encode 8 bits of color data, a trade-off that I am more than happy to make when it comes to the performance, reliability, and overall usability of this. Or if you have to use the 4 mechanism for more tolerant timing, then, well, it's a little bit less efficient on memory, but it is a lot easier to encode, and it only takes 16 bits of space to encode 4 bits of color data, so 32 bits for the same size as 24. Once this data is loaded into the data buffer, which it can be done at any time, even while the DMA is operating, it's then shifted out by the DMA in its own time, without the core doing anything. What we get from this is a tiny little ESP8266 that can talk over the network and receive WS2812 data, outputting it to, in this case, 296 WS2812s reliably without even breaking a sweat. How cool is that?